Well, Arena examines the extraordinary life and career of one of the most influential figures of British pop in the 50s and 60s. The strange story of Joe Meek.
The pop producer Joe Meek and his landlady, Mrs. Violet Shenton, were found dead from shotgun wounds earlier today in his North London studios. Meek, 37, had a string of hits in the early 60s, including Johnny Remember Me and Have I the Right? But it was Telstar, his own composition, for which he will best be remembered. No one else is being sought in connection with the killings.
Hello everyone, my name's Joe Meek. In the next hour, I'm going to bring you some of the things that I've been doing in the last 2 years. It may not interest you all that much, but I can assure you it's very interesting. For instance, have you ever met Marlene Dietrich or Johnny Ray or Norman Wisdom? Well, I have. It's rather a long story, but in this hour, I'm trying to bring you some of the most interesting points and try to describe some of the things that I've been doing.
Tonight, Arena tells the story of one of the most curious characters in the history of British popular music, Joe Meek, the man who claimed to paint pictures in sound. Hitmaker to Britain's first generation of homegrown pop stars, he was an outsider who single-handedly challenged the supremacy of the established recording industry. He felt he had a destiny, that he was the man who was going to invent a new sound for a new era.
Dear Mum, well, lots of things have happened since my last letter. First, the boy I put on Decca Records was in last week's Daily Mirror. Now, here's the nice bit. He was so grateful, he has given me 5% of all his record royalties for 2 years. So, all I can say is it pays to be kind and help others as much as you can. Some let you down, but you are rewarded in the end. I have over 50 songs, all written by myself, and I will release them when I feel the time is right. I'm sure your son is going to be famous one day, Mum. As things are going good, I am very well known in the whole record world. So all the best with everything from your loving son, Joe.
Joe was pantomime mad. You know, he'd get them all up the show and have a little pantomime. He'd buy clothes and that, wouldn't he, Joe?
Well, yeah, he did. And he used to have a shed up at the top of the garden. And they used to put on their own little shows up there from when he was a little boy. And have all the his friends and that in and dress them all up as different characters. And they did put on a little play and charge the locals to come in and watch the play.
And what did the locals think?
They loved it. Some of the comments weren't too...
Why? What sort of comments did they?
Well, some of the rougher type of boys like ourselves went and watched it, and we didn't think too much of it.
Why?
Well, they was dressed up in women's clothes, and that didn't suit us really.
He was an indoor boy, and we were outdoor boys, weren't we?
Yeah. You see, outdoor boys is rougher and readier than Joe was. Joe wasn't rough and ready anyway. I mean, to us, he was entirely different. I mean, we would be out shooting, fishing, rambling about, whereas Joe'd be up in his little shed up the garden, working with his wirelesses and what have you.
I was about 5 years old when I first wanted a gramophone, and it was one of those toy gramophones with a celluloid sound box and a key to wind it up. And then I discovered if you play the record at the end on the run-out groove, you could shout down the sound chamber and the sound would be imprinted in the grooves. And I thought that I'd discovered something marvellous. And of course, I was really doing just what Edison had discovered years before.
You moved to a farm, didn't you?
Me and Joe, Dinmore Hill, that is.
Oh, yes, that
Dinmore.
Was...
I left school, I went to look after that, and when Joe left school, he come up and helped me.
And you, both of you, together looked after the farm on your own?
Yeah.
And what did Joe do? What's his contribution to
Well, that? Joe used to do all the cooking and all the cleaning and feed the cattle and that, you know. He used to muck in, same as me. I used to milk a couple of cows and that, and...
But he was, he had special meals that he would cook for you, didn't he?
Yeah, see, he was a great cook, our Joe. He was a great cook.
And what sort of stuff did he cook?
He was very fond of sausages.
And what was the other thing, wasn't it?
Artichokes in the garden. There was artichokes in the garden when we got there. And Joe liked them. Have you ever tasted artichokes?
No.
No. I have, they're a bit soapy. Like potatoes, only a bit soapy.
And then I went in the forces when I was 18 and became a radar mechanic. And also I was pretty handy around the camp at repairing radios and record players. When I came out, in the meantime my father had died, I decided that I must take the plunge and move to London and take a job connected with recording. And so I came to London and took a job in Stone's radio shop in Edgware Road.
The Londoner greeted Meek was just emerging from the throes of post-war austerity. His fascination with sound and all things electronic enabled him to get a job at Stone's, one of London's biggest record stores. Musically, the stars of the day were middle-aged and middle of the road. There, he began to establish his first contacts with the recording business, and even began to accumulate his own recording equipment.
Midnight, one more night without sleeping. Watching till the morning comes.
He moved into a flat in Notting Hill with a friend he'd met in London called Lionel Howard. Their friendship lasted almost till Meek's death. Meek reserved one room in the flat for a makeshift studio.
What's behind the green door? Knocked once, tried to tell him I'd been there.
Used to have mics all over the house and record whatever we were saying. Didn't matter who was there. Like, you never knew whether he was being recorded or whether you weren't.
What did he do with those recordings?
He'll play them back to us sometime.
Was that not embarrassing?
Very. Sometimes.
He used to play the music up in the cherry orchard. When the cherry pickers were picking the cherries, Joe would have loudspeakers up in the trees to play the pickers' music. They loved that, didn't they?
Yeah.
After various jobs in the recording industry, he landed a job at Lansdowne, a studio that recorded the likes of Joan Regan, Edmund Hockridge and Anne Shelton for the major record companies. Meek was hired as an assistant engineer, but from the word go, he was determined to do things his way. And despite his junior status, he engineered some of the biggest hits of the day, like Green Door and Lay Down Your Arms. What's more, he thought of them as his hits. An
order is an order. Well, now we're on the subject of records, I'd like to play you some of my latest ones that are doing quite well on the market. First of all, we have Anne Shelton with Lay Down Your Arms. I did this recording about a month ago, and we used, for the marching feet, we used a box with gravel in it. This record is going right to the top.
There were no rules about how to get the best sound, as far as he was concerned.
He had a little piece of ex-army equipment in a green box, and we had, it took me a long time to find out what this was, but he made this spring echo device, and it was his secret box with his secret sounds, as he used to say, and he wouldn't tell anybody what he was doing. He used to hitch this box up and just use it in all sorts of ways to process the sounds that were going through it, and would keep it locked away. It was all taped up with black tape. You couldn't get near it.
While Meek was at Lansdowne, he recorded many of the top British jazz musicians, Acca Bilk, Chris Barber, and Humphrey Littleton.
Go into monumental sulks, because in jazz the general idea is you stick a mic up and you get however many mics, and you get as natural a sound as you possibly can without monkeying about. And Joe over-recorded the drum brushes, Stan Gregg playing the brushes, just normally just doing a little offbeat and chop and chop, and he bumped these up, and he also did something very peculiar in the way of distorting the left hand of the piano. So that octave, rolling octave thing, boom, 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 on the record sounds very, very peculiar indeed. And it's very difficult to play it on a... and recapture it on a live thing, because that's not the actual sound that comes out of the piano. And Joe had deliberately distorted the thing. And had I not gone on holiday, and had it been a setup like we have now, where you all gather around and listen to a playback, I would have had a fit. I would have said, that's dreadful. And I would have thrown Joe into one of his sulks, because I would have said that, you know, you've over-recorded the drums and I don't want it. And you've distorted the piano sound and I don't want that either. But in fact, I wasn't there. And so it all came out like that and became a hit, I think, for those reasons. That was a new world for me, that idea of a sound engineer not doing what you tell him, but actually mixing and twiddling the knobs and distorting things. That was a totally new thing to me.
Strange, yeah, many people take.
By the late 50s, Meek was clear that there was a new audience ready for his kind of music and a different type of performer ready to play it.
It was casual to the nth degree. It was made up on the spot, and everybody was totally surprised when the public went out and actually bought these things. I mean, we created a market. This record market did not exist at that point in time. People did not go out, particularly teenagers, up until that time. 14-year-olds were at work. I was at work at 14. We didn't have the kind of money to go out and buy records. So, I mean, teenagers buying records was a whole brand... Teenagers buying anything was a whole brand new market. So the whole thing was like man emerging from the sea. There was no design at all. The big companies made their own recordings, employed their own staff, and hired musicians and singers on a musicians' union fee basis. For instance, when I made Rock Island Line, I got £3.10 for singing Rock Island Line. No royalties. There were no royalties then.
Meek soon found the hierarchy of the recording establishment intolerable. He also felt his employers at Lansdowne were unresponsive to his ideas and his songs. After a row, he walked out.
Well, he had a temper. We all got tempers, the Meeks. But Joe lived on a short fuse. But it was over and done with. He'd flare up and then he was back and normal again. But he did have a temper.
Well, I then wrote a song called Put a Ring on Her Finger, which was quite a big hit here and also in America and brought me in quite a lot of money. The difficulty was finding premises to make the recordings because I realised using other independent studios were very expensive. In the end, I found this building in Holloway Road, which gave me three floors. The ground floor is occupied by a leather shop. Had a good shop, and well, I decided this was the place for me. I'll describe first of all the studio itself. It's on the third floor, and it's the size of an average bedroom, no larger. Now, when I first started recording here, I used to get a lot of leg pulls from these musicians who are top musicians and often playing in mandolinas orchestras, classical orchestras, and they used to come in and they used to look around and they'd say, well, where do you want me? Am I supposed to be in the bathroom?
I'll meet you at your locker when the school's dismissed. I'll carry your books home if you'll just give me one little
This was a complete unit to produce and press the records. And the third record turned out to be a hit. It was Angela Jones by Michael Cox. But this brought on a lot of difficulties because the major record companies decided that they didn't want small operatives. And so they did their best to squash us out of the shops.
Joe Meek was one of the first to actually make product and then lease that to record companies. They reluctantly took it, but he had a style and he had a sound and a certain vision. And of course, he made a path for people like myself who came some 1 or 2 years later. I mean, the hipper people in the industry thought he was, unique, recording at home in his flat and all that sort of stuff. That was something special. I think the industry itself, record companies and all that, thought probably it was a crank. Because they thought anybody that didn't play by the rules were, because they were, record companies were very, very disciplined in terms of the way they went about recording. It wasn't at that time when you worked in a recording studio. I remember you had to wear a collar and a tie and a suit, and the engineers used to wear white white jackets like doctors. And I remember a sign up at EMI Studios in Abbey Road where it said sports trousers and jackets may be worn on Saturdays. that was just the people working in the studios, you know, the engineers. That's how disciplined the whole thing, recording was. And they took it all rather seriously. And there's this guy making these records that are selling millions in his kitchen.
How are you, Mr. Gilmore? How are you? My name's Molly Davidson, and I look after the boy here, and I'm also the leader of the Saints. So if there's anything at all you want, if you need something, you come to me, all right?
Okay. Hello, Mr. Gilmore.
How are you?
I'm Johnny Sincere.
Hello.
I did recognize you. This is Sammy Rivers.
You'll have to excuse me. It's such a long time ago that our memory tends to sort of fade a bit. Had I known we were going to have this interview 30 years ago, I would have paid more attention. I was, as you know, an actor, and I was offered a role on a television series at the time called Harper's West One. And I played the part of a rock and roll star that goes along and opens up the record department in the store.
We're sorry about the hold-up, but we'll be swinging real...
We had just recorded Johnny Remember Me. Anyway, I in fact sang the song on the show.
When the mists are rising and the rain is falling and the wind is blowing cold across the moor.
And powers of television, it went straight into the hit parade. Hey presto, I was a pop star.
The girl I loved and lost a year ago. To believe I know, but I hear her singing in the sign of the wind blowing in the treetops way above me.
When I recorded Johnny Remember Me, I was in the sitting room. I was in the sitting room behind a little screen, and the rhythm section was in the sitting room with me. The violin section were on the stairs. The backing singers were practically in the loo. And the brass section were underneath, on another floor altogether. And then was Joe next door, playing his machine like a musical instrument, really. Quite bizarre, it really was.
Yes, I'll always remember till the day I die.
Rising and the rain is falling, the wind is blowing cold across the moor. I hear the voice of my darling, the girl I loved and lost a year ago. Went to number one. I telephoned Joe from the phone box on Paddington Station and asked him if there was anything going, anything happening. And he said, we're looking for a song for John Layton, who was going to appear in a series on the television. He said, if you can come up with something by Monday, he said, you might use it. So I went home and woke up on the Sunday and wrote Johnny Remember Me in 10 minutes.
Johnny Remember Me was one of the classic examples of the eerie Joe Meek sound. Both he and Goddard felt that their inspiration might have come from beyond the grave.
I used to play Holly's records every day of the week. And Joe Meek also was obsessed with Buddy Holly.
Yeah, see, I always had an interest in the occult. You know, we had visits from Buddy Holly last night, and the fact that Buddy Holly was coming to visit him and talking to him and helping him with guidance.
holding this seance at his flat in Holloway Road, fingers on the tumbler, goes round to the letters on the table. And we asked, would Johnny Remember Me be a hit? And it spelt out that it would go to number one. And then we asked if the tribute that I'd written to Buddy Holly would be a hit. And it answered, see you in the charts.
We'll always remember
Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly was killed in a plane crash in 1959. But his songs will always be remembered. Always.
Ah, I used to know that Joe Meek. Well, I was amazed because I had the address and I pulled up with my hearse at the time with the coffin in the back and pulled it out and I was looking for it, I think, because he was macabre and liked horror stuff. And it's all I could find was this leather shop. And Mrs. Shelton, I couldn't believe it. It was just above that. And so I asked him there, they said, oh, he lives above. And then when I went up these rickety stairs, I couldn't believe this is where all these number one records come from, you know.
Eyes are red, I laugh like gurgling water.
Is that the letter you want to give?
Yes.
Well, yeah, oh, fair enough. Right. It's a bit over the top. Okay. Well, went a bit weird that time.
Yeah, well,
I did notice that he was always asking members of my band to stay over after we'd done 2 or 3 hours in the studio to do a bit of overdubbing. I think he called it overdubbing. But they said, oh, I'm not going up there again on my own, you know. But it was always, I noticed, I was very naive. He was never the ugly ones in the band, you know. He was never the ugly sax player or the drummer without any teeth.
I think now it would be a good idea if I describe a rather typical day in my life. It starts about 9:30, the phone begins to ring merrily away, and as a rule, most days I have some form of recording to do. We'll say, today I'm going to make a record with a new artist to be brought round to me and I feel has potential. I've auditioned him and he has a different sound and voice and I feel has the sort of looks that could appeal to the public.
Earlier this evening, you know what this is. You weren't, let me say very quickly, it is the near miracle satellite now in orbit in space, some hiding coyly somewhere behind the horizon, which we hope in just 1 hour from now, during this very program, is going to transmit to us the first ever live public television pictures from the United States of America.
I can't see anything that looks very exciting happening at the moment.
We used to have Telstar going around our house regularly. It's a marvellous tune, you know, full of light.
Things, I think, must be hotting up by now. I can see from where I'm sitting. Let's go over to now, a picture in Gunilly in Cornwall. Here it is.
There's a flicker there. Here we are.
Here we are. There's a bar. Now, we are that's a man's face. There it is. There it is. You see it for yourself. That's the picture.
Meek's tribute to the first communication satellite, a subject close to his heart, went to number one in Britain and America. It should have set him up for life.
When we went into the control room, we stood there listening to it played back. It just sounded tremendous. I remember there was a terrific thunderstorm at the time. This had happened before. I think Johnny remembered me. So we felt that perhaps was an omen, and this was going to be another big smash hit.
I'm absolutely honest. When we finished it and Joe sent me a copy, I played it, I thought, God, I can't tell anybody I played on that.
Joe knew what he wanted. He had the idea in his head and the sound. And when we heard it, when he said, listen, you know, we couldn't believe it.
What can you do? Tell us what you thought.
Crap.
I have quite a lot of odd sound to me. I made the John Layton hits, Johnny Remember Me, Wild Wind, and the Mike Berry tribute to Buddy Holly. Then, of course, there was a Moon Trekkers, Night of the Vampire, and Danny Rivers, Can't You Hear My Heart? Ian Gregory's Can't You Hear the Beat of a Broken Heart? And then, of course, up came Telstar. So, altogether, that's about 8 hits I've had.
Yes, I imagine it was his finest moment. He really thought he had everything in his hand. And he thought it would continue, you know. That time had come. Now he's got a multi-million selling record. The money must roll in, and we can do bigger and better things. But it wasn't to be.
During Telstar Mania, the Tornadoes bass player captured the public's imagination, largely because Meek had persuaded him to dye his hair blonde to make him stand out from the rest of the group. His name was Heinz Burt. Meek changed it simply to Heinz.
Let me put it this way. Somebody promises you the earth, and you're playing in a small town, and all of a sudden, before you know it, there you are, the London Palladium. Bearing in mind I was, 18? Odd. I thought, well, the man knows what he's on about. It's going to happen. And it did. The only thing didn't happen was the money.
The money?
Yeah. And that's what life's all about, let's face it.
You lived there, though, for a while, didn't you?
Yes, I lived at the flat above the studio.
How soon afterwards was that? How soon after you met him?
Well, practically then, because I came from Eastleigh and I had nowhere to stay. Right. So I stayed at the flat there. But for about 3 years.
And he lived there as well?
Yeah.
Meek intended Heinz to have a place among the first luminaries of the British pop scene. Wild, Faith, Fury, Richard, and Conrad.
I was very popular at the time. I was voted England's most popular singer in 1961. They called me the face of 1960. Joe also looked after a boy called Heinz, who didn't like the idea of Jess Conrad coming into the stable at all. Great jealousy there. And we were doing a show at Walthamstow Empire, whatever it was called, somewhere in that area. North London, anyway. And Heinz was on the show, I was doing my act. And I know I was being spied on by a couple of his band. We all had our own bands then. We didn't share bands. And I went very well. Always went well, but I mean, this particular performance, I scored a rundown on my first number, which means the whole audience get up and run towards the stage. Anyway, we met in the corridor backstage, and Heinz said to me, you nicked my act, Jess, you nicked my act. You jumped on the amp. And I said, don't be silly, Heinz, please, grow up. I said, what do you mean I said, to tell you the truth, I said, we've all nicked Elvis's act. I mean, anybody can jump up on an amplifier or on a piano. But I didn't normally do that, but I did it on that night. And I didn't know he jumped up on the amp because I never watched him. I watched people like Gene Vincent, Jerry Lee Lewis, but not Heinz. And I figured that he didn't have an awful lot to teach me. Anyway, I grabbed him and I bit his nose off. And he squeaked like a pig. Well, most people would. And I threw him against the wall, and he goes off, and there's a big schmazzle backstage, and there's a stage manager, and I go back into my dressing room, taking bits of Heinz's nose out of my teeth. I mean, Heinz's nose has never been a delicacy, not even then. And when I look back on it, I mean, it's horrendous, but we did those things then. We were rebels. Anyway, we had a fight, and Joe Meek got to hear that we had this fight, and of course, Heinz was his golden boy. I touched Heinz. So that was it. I got this letter saying he no longer wanted to recall me.
Do you think, looking back on it, do you think he was in love with you?
Yes.
It was an infatuation. I think so. It was a thing, let's put it this way. If there's something you can't have, you want it even more. And I think that was the thing with him. Where I told him to get off, I wasn't into that sort of thing. It was this thing, it's the same. I mean, everyone, if there's something you can't have, you want it even more.
But what Meek wanted wasn't to be. Heinz had only one substantial hit. It was another Goddard tribute, Just Like Eddie. However, it didn't shake Meek's faith in his own judgment.
Sadly, it did go to his head a bit. Got a bit carried away, made the great record producer. It was a tremendous achievement, there's no doubt. But it did seem to produce a change. The friendly, sort of down-to-earth Joe we knew before had changed somewhat. I remember an example. A boy came to the door once for an audition. He'd come all the way from up north somewhere. Normally, he would have been welcomed, you know, come on in. But no, I'm too busy, says Joe. I can't see him. Tell him to go away. It's terrible. Had to go all the way back home. That's a silly example, perhaps, but just one of how he changed. Great man now. Which seemed rather a pity.
Loneliness, whoa. He's got his claws in me. Loneliness, whoa. Seems to be my destiny, made to cry in the night. No one seems to treat me right. Loneliness, woe. What's to become of me? Happiness, yeah, yeah. Always seems to pass me by. Happiness, yeah, yeah. Some to this lonely boy, I can treat someone good with everything a lover should. Loneliness, whoa, what's to become of me?
Why I adored the music of Joe Meek was that it was incredibly inventive and different. Telstar by the Tornadoes, Have I the Right by the Honeycombs. It was a different sound. It was as different in its own way as Phil Spector's sounds over the in America at the time. He was making all the Righteous Brothers and Ike and Tina Turner, and also Bob Crewe, who was doing all the Four Seasons stuff. And I became very fascinated by the production end of things. And I approached Joe Meek and said, would he please make a record with me? And I sent in this demo of this song and was surprised to hear from him that, yes, he was prepared to have a go. So I went up and met him. He was very charming and very nice in this strange little place in the Holloway Road. I was full of trepidation. I mean, I was only a teenager anyway. I was nervous as hell. I'd heard a lot of things about his reputation. I was worried that I was getting... I mean, he had a terrible reputation as a raging old queen, and I thought I would immediately be groped. I wasn't, I hastened to add, which I since regard as thoroughly unflattering. He was terribly nice, dug out this old acetate, scratched old acetate, of a song that he'd written, and we went in to record it. And it was a truly amazing experience because, apart from anything else, I'd never known before or since the bass drum sound. He said, oh, we won't need that, looking at the drummer's bass drum, which, of course, immediately offended the drummer, who I think had a seizure and has not recovered since. He said, no, we won't need that. He said, what I'll do is I'll do the bass drum sound while you're playing the rest of the track. And he unwound this old BBC radio microphone that was bound up in sort of felt and all sorts of other things, and he took it round the corner from the bedroom where the record was being made, where we were playing, into the bathroom. And he stood in the bath with one foot in the bath and one foot on the floor, the bare floorboards outside the bath. and he stamped on the bare floorboards in time with the record. And of course, if we made a mistake, he was listening through his headphones, he'd shout through the door, "No, no good, do it again." And the microphone was miking this stamping on the floorboards. And sure enough, he got the Joe Meek bass drum sound, which was this incredible sort of thuddy sort of sound, which people spent millions in recording studios for many years, many decades after that to emulate, but they never knew that's how Joe did it.
In the middle of a session, once we was doing a quiet bit with a bit of acoustic guitar, not electric acoustic, you know, and we'd done a lot of mad knocking on the coffin lid and all this coming out of my coffin, and Jack the Ripper was done all that, and very loud. So we cut that to this quiet bit, and all of a sudden there's a banging, you know, dump, you know, all that routine. And he said, "Who's that? That drummer's bloody..." And he come in and they got the drummer. The drummer said, "I didn't touch nothing." So he had another gun, it was still doing this. And he said, "The drummer's definitely banging his drum." But he said, "We're not." And then he come in and he said, "Look, I'm not even standing by the drums." He got out, you know, he stood by the side. And it was knocking, you know, like a ghost. And he said, "It's that bloody woman again." And what she does, she's banging with a broom, you know, a broom handle. The old broom, she was banging on the ceiling, see? So, and he said, "It's completely ruined the bleeding session." And he would go out there, "Stop it, you silly old bag, you know. We're trying to work up here, you know." And she said, "This is supposed to be a private house. This ain't a recording studio, you know. This isn't Las Vegas."
Of a London kind of never say yay.
The Ripper.
Yeah. When never Jack the Ripper ever shows his face.
The Ripper.
Yeah.
Jack the Ripper.
So you pretty little girl, you better watch your step.
The Ripper.
Yeah.
Jack the Ripper.
Yeah. Hey, Jack. Late at night.
The Ripper.
Yeah.
Jack the Ripper.
Well, then disaster struck, of course, in the following year, 1963, when he was picked up by the police, importuning for immoral purposes. And this appeared in the newspaper. And he was terribly upset about that. Such a showing up, of course. And from then on, everything went wrong.
He was frightened to face the world after that for quite a long time. He was lucky. He didn't hit the press in a big way. He expected to see Joe Meek arrested in big headlines in the Daily Mirror the next morning. You know, and everything would be finished. He visualised, "I'm ruined. This is going to ruin me. Everybody now is going to know I'm queer and cut me off." This was his reaction. Secondly, he was terrified that his family would find out. If his mother ever got wind of what this, he would be finished, I think, mentally.
No, that was a big shock. But these things happen. I think a lot of it was blackmail, you know. I think Joe was blackmailed a lot. By some people.
Why would they?
I don't think Joe was as bad as they made out to be. Not his social life. Because he had plenty of girlfriends up here, you know. And he had a lot of people didn't like him. They were a bit jealous of him. And I know he told me once he was being blackmailed. But it never rung a bell to me, you know.
Peter Patter, what's the matter? Peter Patter, what's the matter? I don't care, no, I won't cry. 'Cause I know my baby loves me, and she'll show it as time goes by. Whoops-a-daisy, it drives me crazy. My, I mustn't tell a lie. Whoops-a-daisy, drives me crazy.
Hey?
I've always said that it's not what you've got, it's the way that you use it. I have developed a recording technique to suit myself. Nobody really tells me what to do. They never used to when I recorded for Phillips and Pye.
This is the pop business as the customers see it. The groups and the fans see pops as one long swinging ring-a-ding rave up, a ball, a good time.
The very last tour I did was in 1964. The virtually unknown group called the Rolling Stones closed the first half, and it was a six-week tour, and as the tour progressed, I sort of noticed that this strange group was getting quite a lot of attention and applause, so we moved them up to the second half, the slot before me. And the last week was quite traumatic. It was a very difficult act for me to follow. And I think the writing was on the wall at the end of that tour.
It's very difficult thing to say exactly what makes a hit record. Because I've come up with quite a few, I'd be rather silly to listen to other people and change it.
Meek didn't think the beat boom would last, but he met the challenge of the new groups with a hit of his own, Have I the Right by the Honeycombs. It was number one for 2 weeks.
Have I the right to hold you? You know I've always told you that we must never, ever part.
Just like all the other hits, Have I the Right was recorded in Meek's flat.
I'm right back, I just can't bear it. I got some love and I long to share it. Come right back where you belong. Oh yeah, you belong. Oh yeah, you belong.
Honey, is this the first record you've made?
Yes, it is the first.
It must be exhausting work playing those drums.
Not really, no.
What's it like being surrounded by four men, then?
Oh, they're all right. I look after them. You know, I do their hair for them, make their tea.
Joe Meek now produces recording tapes only, leaving the big record companies to make and distribute his records. But even here, he has his problems.
Again, I met with a lot of difficulties because I kept coming up with hits. And the A&R men and different people tied to these major companies were inclined to be a little bit envious and complained about the plugs my records were getting. And so I have to watch these people like a hawk.
In a letter to a colleague, Meek wrote, "No one should be left in the office alone, even if you think they can be completely trusted or are friends of mine. It's important also that no one is allowed in the control room or studio without Dennis or Michael around. Always check with me if it could be safe to leave them there to rehearse, wait, or hang around. Always keep bottom door locked unless I say otherwise."
I went for a period with him where he says, I started to talk to him. I said, "Oh, yeah, about the new record we're going to do this." "Oh, don't talk here. Don't talk here." And he took me in the passage and he's looking around. He said, "Oh, well, don't talk here, right?" And I said, "Well, where should we talk?" He said, "Halfway down the stairs." And I said, "Well, what's up then?" He said, "It's being bugged." He said, "The place is bugged." I said, "What is it? The Russians? Who is it?" And he said, "No, it's..." He said, "He's done a songwriter. So they come in here and they put a bug here because they keep beating me. I keep getting this idea for a song and someone else does it." I said, "Well, you don't think that's a coincidence?" He said, "No, they're deliberately bugging my flat."
Meek was no businessman, and he'd suffered severe financial problems since Telstar. Sued by a French composer for stealing the tune, he'd never received any royalties. But confident he would win the case, he'd been spending heavily against the money that he believed was due to him.
Well, I woke up one morning and thought, right, all the stardust, all the glitter is gone now. Where is the money? And that's when problems started. I bought a boat, for instance. Globetrotter, it was called, after our third record.
And I used to love that because I love fishing, you know. And one day I just turned up to go out fishing and it was gone. Went to the harbour bloke, I said, where's the boat gone? He said, oh, they come with papers, it's been sold. I thought, charming. A similar thing happened to my car. A Zephyr 6 estate I had, brand spanking new. All of a sudden somebody at the door, come to the door, I've come for the car. I said, what are you talking about? Come for the car. He said, there's the papers. I've just bought it for Mines Burke Limited. And he drove off with the car. I was carless as well.
To locations like this, in this particular graveyard, one reason was that Joe wanted to capture sounds like he used on Screaming Lord Sutch's record till the following night. And the other reason was that he hoped to capture sounds of the supernatural, people from the other side. And one time we came across this cat and it seemed to talk in half-human tones. He recorded that on his portable tape recorder, and we've still got that for posterity.
By 1966, the pop music world had changed out of all recognition. Have I the Right was Meek's last top 10 hit, and his output diminished to a trickle.
Now, I used to go shooting a lot because of the pressure working, obviously, gigs. I used to travel, I had a breakdown shotgun that you broke down into bits, fitted in the case, used to have it in the car. And I'd go, say one night I was in Carlisle, and next night Doncaster, and I'd be travelling and I'd stop off at a farm, knock at a farm door and say, would you mind if I do a bit of shooting? Because that was my relaxation. I used to go out and shoot a few pigeons and rabbits. And I didn't like to leave it in the car. So I had a recording session, so I took it out of the car, left the shotgun and the cartridges in the studio. Of course, I forgot about them. That was after I moved out of there. A couple of weeks later, there was a big argument about money.
Between you and Joe?
Yeah, between Joe and myself, about money. And I said to Joe, I said, look, if you don't square me for royalties, you can stuff the lot, and you know where to stuff it. And he said, well, I'll finish you. He said, I made you and I'll break you. He said, you'd never record for anybody else. He said, I'll make sure of that. So out I went in a temper, that was it. The end of it, and the next thing I knew was detectives knocking at the door.
Well, I woke up about 8 o'clock. I went downstairs and he was cooking toast. He had toast going, which was burning. I took it off the stove, it was all burning. I made some fresh toast, put it on the table with some coffee, and Joe drank it and ate the toast. And he wasn't talking to me at all now. He was, he must have been well peeled up. He took a painting off the wall, one that he'd painted himself, put it next to the electric fire and let it burn. And he said, they're not effing well getting this. And then he gave me the final note. I'm leaving now. I'm going now, I think it said. Goodbye. And he went straight upstairs. And then the next thing I hear, I could hear music again. 2 or 3 minutes later, up come Mrs. Shenton. Well, she just whispered to me, what's going on? You know, what sort of mood is he in today? I said, oh, God, you know, he's in a terrible mood today. She said, oh, I'll sort him out, love, don't worry. Where is he? I said, he's up in the studio. Oh, don't worry, she said, I'll sort him out. With that, she gave me the cigarette that she was smoking. She said, can you hold on to that for a minute, please? Meaning that she was only going to be up there a second. And I took the cigarette from her. I walked into the office and put it in the ashtray. And she was upstairs, and all of a sudden I could hear, calm down, Joe. Where's the book, he said. Joe said, I want the book. I've always drawn the conclusion it must have been the rent book. Because there'd been a lot of problems with the rent being paid and the lease of the building was about to run out. And I just walked back into the office and I heard the bang. I mean, it was an almighty bang. I ran out. I was just about to run up the stairs and Mrs. Shenton was falling down. And she fell down right to the bottom of the stairs, right into my arms. And I was instantly sort of shocked. I really didn't know what had happened. Then I gently sort of pulled her down and I just shouted up, she's dead. You know, I assumed that she was dead. I had no idea if she was, but I assumed she must have been. I attempted to run up the stairs when I heard the second bang. And I sort of looked over and I could see Joe lying on the floor. Had a gun beside him.
Well, he was very high strung up in the last 12 months.
He was a sick man the last 6 months, there's no doubt about that. He was taking these tablets for depression, and they didn't seem to do him a lot of good. But he needed a real good rest, that's what he needed.
He should have come home before.
He should have come home and had a good rest, and he'd have been all right.
But were you aware of any reasons why he needed to rest?
Well, we knew he was overworked, I mean.
Well, the pressure was getting to him when they done. I mean, he lives in a different world in London.
If I call out your name like a song.
Joe Meek shot himself on the 8th anniversary of the death of his idol, Buddy Holly. A year later, his family won the case for the royalties from Telstar.
One of my favourites is one of the last records he made was by the Crying Shames called Please Stay. Have you heard it? I like that. It's a nice record.
Be different. Please stay.
I think that's about all. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity. And if there is anything else I can help you with, please let me know.